talk to you or share with you what I've learned about e-learning over the last 15, 20 years. I think we've been studying e-learning and designing different types of learning environments, particularly how to facilitate e-learning and design 21st century e-learning, modern e-learning environments, but doing so grounded in research and theory. By the way, everyone just calls me 2C. That's why. Much easier than students call me other names, but I won't mention those. Just start off with a little context. Throughout the years, I found that really, with insufficient time, training, tools, incentives, educators, instructional designers have very little recourse but to rely on past practice, what they know best. If you don't have much time, much resources, you have to fall back on what you know best. And what typically most educators know best is this teacher-directed or teacher-centered instructional methods and materials. And I would argue that that's why most e-learning programs, if you look at them today, still mimic correspondence mail models of distance ed. Read a lot of stuff, do a couple activities, submit your assignment, and hopefully pass the class. You remember some few things from it, but that's really just about it. So what is wrong with instructor-led methods online? Well, PowerPoints and text-based materials tend to focus on the transmission of knowledge. I have all this information and knowledge in my head, and I'm going to pour it into your brain so you can memorize it for the next test, and pretty much that's it. They typically have limited interactions, resulting in feelings of isolation and anonymity. They lack social interactions that's really necessary for people to interpret and construct knowledge. If you think about it, instructor-led materials are really based on the tradition of speaking and listening. Online, how does most learning occur? Reading and writing. So the question is the materials that you design for speaking and listening really appropriate for an environment that relies on reading and writing? So I'd argue that most online programs are not very engaging. It's the instructor who's standing in front of a classroom that makes the content come alive. Typically, most online programs are not very engaging, and therefore, we feel like they fail to really utilize the potential of emerging technologies to facilitate individual and group learning. Do I look like that? No, I think I look like that. Anyways. So what is the key difference? Why is it so difficult for people who may be brilliant in an instructor-led classroom? Why is it so difficult for him or her to take what he or she does and knows and go online and produce brilliant online coursework? If you had to summarize it in less than one sentence, what do you think the one thing is that really makes it difficult to go from a traditional environment to the more modern online system?
To write it down.
Getting it transferred online, okay? No face-to-face interaction, so it's difficult to engage people without that face. Hard to maybe interpret verbal, nonverbal cues. Communication, really, the interaction. How do you get the communication going on? Although I found in many online programs you can get more communications with individuals who may not speak up in a face-to-face environment. How so?
Well, when you go to the class, you're in class time.
Yes, more distractions possibly. Okay, Ken, how about you? You've been studying this a lot. What do you think? One sentence or less.
When there's lots of freedom in web-based education, you know, limitless opportunity.
More than one sentence. Sorry, one sentence or less.
Limitless possibilities creates endless procrastination.
There you go. Limitless possibilities. Very good. Okay, others. Yeah, sir. There you go, opportunities, and I would kind of agree with that. In my opinion, I think it all boils down to the spontaneity of interactions. Think about what a really good instructor, not necessarily a bad one, but a really good instructor does in a face-to-face classroom. he or she will interpret verbal and nonverbal cues. Bored or working on something else, you might get there. Okay. Clarify expectations, address individual needs and concerns, provide insights, elaborations, give directions, facilitate discussion, present immediate feedback, and I could probably go on and on and on. In an online environment, we know we had limited real-time opportunities, right, for that spontaneous interaction. Interactive technologies do not ensure meaningful. How many of you have been on a ITV system, interactive television system? Anybody? What happens when the instructor goes, any questions? Silence, typically, right? How many of you have joined a chat session for a class? Is it really meaningful interactions going on? How about online discussions through discussion forums and those kinds? If it's structured or planned, but I guess that's what I'm trying to get at, these interactions that are typically spontaneous and intuitive to good educators must be very carefully planned and sequenced as an integral part of e-learning. And I found that subject matter experts, educators, they can codify the knowledge, they could take the information, it's an arduous process like writing a textbook almost, but they could put it online. What's so difficult I found is they have a hard time planning and sequencing all of these interactions that occur in a face-to-face environment, often spontaneously based on intuition. How do you plan for those in an online environment? So with the realization that interactions are key, what do we know about interactions? We have lots of research, probably 10, 20, 30, if you go on to distance education, 50 to more years of research on interactions. Well, it enables communications to address individual needs and interests. Without some kind of communication, we can't get at individual needs and interests. Reduces feelings of isolation and anonymity. Interaction is a tool for transforming instructor-led methods and materials to more learner-centered or student-centered environments. Interactions, Michael Moore says, yes, it's the defining characteristic and vital to distance education. Greg Kiersey, also a leader in the field, believes that's the single most important element in e-learning. Well, what else do we know? If you read the literature, you find many definitions of interactions online and interactivity. One very basic definition, just a learner accessing a page of text via web interface and reading some content. More complex definition, five criteria for interactivity. Interruptibility, graceful degradation, limited look. What the hell does all that mean? I don't really know what all that. The point is there's lots of definitions going from very simple to complex in the literature. I love this quote from Shale and Garrison. Without interactions, instruction can be the passing on content as if it were the dogmatic truth in the cycle of knowledge acquisition, critical evaluation, and knowledge validation that is so important for higher order thinking skills can be non-existent. Agree with that? Makes sense. So what else do we know about interactivity and interactions online? Many have published frameworks that classify the different types of interactions that may occur online. But probably the most well-known one, published by Michael Moore, suggests that there are student-teacher, student-student, student-content interactions. With the advances in technology, Hillman and his or her colleagues suggested that the student interface interaction is critical for facilitating learning. Others have talked about student instructional, student social. Montero Murphy at University of Texas said, wait a second, let's look at it from the instructor side. And we have to remember the instructor support staff and peers and the organizational interactions are also critical for facilitating e-learning. We also find what I call more purpose-based frameworks for classifying e-learning. Synchronous, asynchronous communications. Purpose is to browse and click, branch, track, coach. Pam Northrup, University of North Florida. Purpose of interactions is to interact with content, monitor, regulate, support. Mike Hanifin, University of Georgia, one of the leaders in the field of computer-based instruction. 5 purposes for interacting. U.S. military, Department of Defense, still uses these 4 levels to actually budget or create budgets for developing technology-based instructional systems and training. They define 4 levels of interactivity, ranging from very passive all the way to real-time participation. And they still use these levels in actually designing their training systems. Continue to read the literature, and we find what I found, a tool-based framework that defines different types of interactions based on the actual tools that are used to facilitate interactivity. So all this knowledge was great and really gave me insights into the breadth and depth and types of interactions they could use to design and facilitate e-learning online, but they failed to define the interrelationships between those interactions. When do I do teacher-teacher? When do I do student-teacher? When do I do student content? It failed to delimit the interrelationship between the interactions, instructional strategy, and the technology. When do I blog? When do I do a discussion forum? When should I use chat? So I would suggest that all those frameworks in the past literature gave us tremendous insights into e-learning and interactivity, but they really didn't give educators a systematic process for planning and designing and sequencing these interactions that are critical to e-learning. So my objectives today, 3 objectives. I want to increase your knowledge, as well as your potential for designing and sequencing meaningful e-learning interactions. I'd like to increase your knowledge and potential for designing student-centered learning environments. I also want to challenge mainly the administrator. Who's administrators in the room? We have a few, right? Program directors, coordinators. I finally want to challenge you, as well as the faculty and staff here, on how do you foster the conditions and set up the environment that's so essential within the organization for fostering and facilitating creativity and change. So those are 3 things I want to target for today. Next 45 minutes. So I'm going to first posit a framework and then situate that framework within a systematic process. So here's the framework. All of that information and knowledge about frameworks that I learned as I read through the literature on e-learning, many hours reading, it all made sense to me as soon as I differentiated 3 levels. Excuse me. Level 1, internal learning. That's what's going on in your head. Maybe not right now, but when you're learning. But what goes on inside an individual as well as a group of people, what is happening inside of their mind, the interactions are occurring internally in terms of learning. And based on how and why people learn, you should be selecting learner-instructional interactions, which would be the instructional strategy, which I define as a comprehensive set of events for achieving a specified set of objectives, lesson, or unit. And that instructional strategy should then guide the design and sequencing of what I call level 2 interactions, where you could have learner-human interactions and learner-non-human interactions. I really want to focus, not focus, but pay attention to these other ones, the learner-other, learner-involved. Lots of times when an instructor goes online, I find that they think everything has to happen online. Well, I don't think I remember reading that anywhere in the Bible or the Quran or any other document, that everything in e-learning has to happen online. I also have a lot of instructors that goes, you know, you can't do what I do online. I have to interact with them personally. And if that I find is maybe they're not able to create experiences maybe with others that will also facilitate the achievement of the objectives. And if they were good designers, maybe through interactions with other experts or other people. Case in point, we were designing an online clinical laboratory science program for nurses at the University of Texas Medical Branch. So how can we do all this laboratory work online, pipetting and doing these really fine motor skills? Well, we designed it so that the students could visit a hospital or clinic in their nearby region and had assessments for experts to watch them apply those skills to make sure that they can. So those interactions didn't actually have to happen with the instructor. I think a lot of egos, you know, the higher the degree, the higher the ego. I think you've all faced that, I'm sure. That they start feeling that all these interactions must come from me if the learners are going to actually learn. So let's not forget interactions with the environment and with others. So as I developed this framework, this really helped me come up with a systematic, grounded way of designing and sequencing all those interactions that typically occur in a good face-to-face classroom environment. So let me situate that framework within a systematic process. How many of you have heard of agile models of instructional design now? A few? How about ADDIE, analysis, design, development, implementation, right? Spiral, rapid prototyping. Okay. People in the field tend to hear these models of how to design learning and instructional programs. I like the newer SAM, which is successive approximation model too. They all have similar components. It's the steps which are taken to apply these components. So when I talk about the design and sequence of interactions, people have already done some type of analysis. People familiar with the field know about goal analysis, subordinate skills analysis, learner in context, about gaining knowledge, gathering information about the context. Okay? Then they get into design, and no matter if you use ADDIE or whatever process, you have to define goals and objectives and learner assessments. What are the expectations? How are you going to evaluate where they got there? During the design process, you also have to define the strategy and select the media. I like this because it really starts with analysis, the entire context. You design and prototype one lesson or unit within your course. And then you have a prototype as well as templates and standards for creating all your other units after you test it. So rather than designing everything all at once, developing everything, and then finding out, oh, shoot, something doesn't work, you created and tested one unit, you have the navigation down, you have your strategy down, you have templates for how you're supposed to frame things and organize things, and then it's relatively easier, to put all the other units together and go further. So I really like this SAM2 kind of approach. So I've broken it down to 5 steps. We're doing the strategy, and I'm assuming you've already defined your objectives and defined your assessments. Okay? So think of a course or unit. How many faculty do we have here? Instructors? Okay. What do you teach?
Librarian.
Okay. Research skills. So think of a training program on research skills. You've defined objectives. Assessments, maybe some type of assessments, and you're focusing on one unit. So how do you apply this process? Again, I broke it into 5 steps, but with practice and with some experience, you actually do probably all 5 at once, or maybe the first 4 at once. I've just broken it down into 5 steps to facilitate this lecture as well as workshops that I give on doing this. But in reality, once you become more knowledgeable about design, and all this kind of happens all at once. So let's start with this question. What is the difference between information, reading a book, going to a movie, listening to some music? What is the difference between that kind of activity or event and going to class? What is the difference between what you do as an educator, an instructional designer, and what a book author might do? You include some kind of activities and events like analysis and discussion as a planned part of your experience. Very good. Other things? Could be. One could be more linear. So movies are pretty linear. You go through kind of step one through step eight and stuff. There's some kind of assessment in learning context, not necessarily in other types of information. Good. Other things.
There's an objective.
There's an objective. Well, textbook authors can have objectives, but they're not explicit. Yeah. They're not really learning, and it could be based on their own instead of what they want the audience to gain from the experience. Very good. So you got objectives, you got assessments, you got these events. Fact-finding versus knowledge. So you're doing something to help people create knowledge rather than just transmitting that information. Very good.
Audience?
Well, in education, most of the time you target for a group of audience, whether it's a massive group of audience or smaller, but information is just
out there. Yeah. Okay, so maybe more focused audience.
I would say that you're dealing with group dynamics.
Group dynamics. Okay, so would you agree that education and training, you have a series of events, activities to facilitate learning, such as objectives and assessments and activities that are designed specifically to enhance learning, where information might not have those sequence of events and activities necessarily? Agree with that? Okay. So then what's the difference between what I would argue happens 90% of the time, which I think is craft-based designs versus grounded designs? I'll put it up here since there's interest. I would argue that most people design instruction and their sequence of events and activities for facilitating learning is based on past practice, opinions, fads, politics, etc. I design training instruction because this is how I learned. Doesn't everyone else learn this way? I can't tell you how many times I've been to conferences specifically for simulations, but other technology-focused instruction and training conferences, and talk to people about their designs. I go, how or why did you design that like that? Oh, because I learned this way. Or because that's what other people told me to do. Or that's how our company's done it for years and years and years and years. Craft-based can work. I would say grounded design, those sequence of events and activities to facilitate learning is based on a synthesis of experience, research, and theory. So let's get into grounded design a little bit more. Yes, sir?
How would past practices differ from experience methods? Is it because it's...
Oh, it's same, but then we're also adding the theory and research. No, it's good. You got to. Experience is essential. You probably know your students and your content is better, as good, well, or better than anyone else in that area. So essential. So grand design, systematic implementation processes that are rooted in established theory and research. We have hundreds of years of research on human learning. Why not utilize some of that? Some key conditions for grounded design. That your designs are rooted in a defensible theoretical framework. So when people ask you, why did you create those series of events and activities, you could defend your designs based on some theory, lines of research. It's consistent with research findings associated with that framework. Generalizable beyond the unique conditions in which you design. And again, I would argue that craft-based can work for a particular situation. It's when you try to take that, your design, and try to transfer them or generalize them to other, maybe similar conditions, they tend to break down. This is multimedia. This is the music that goes along with the presentation. Validated through successive implementations. How many of you can say that they take a grounded approach to the design of training and education materials? So a little bit. Good. Relatively rare, especially in industry. Oh, very much so, because we have subject matter experts, typically, who are not trained in pedagogy and learning theories and instructional theory. Because without training and time and resources, that's all they could rely on was what they know. So grounded design, I would argue, is really allows you to align research theory and your practice. It helps you explain and predict your results. Working with some engineers right now and faculty at the College of Medicine, we're creating virtual patient simulations. And they're creating all these different tools and testing, and they just did one on reflectivity, because they thought reflection was important in the learning process. So they created these tools, created these hypotheses, designed this experiment, and then we asked them, well, what is the foundation for your hypotheses and your design? Well, I heard this lecture by this person on reflection. And then we're going to just base it on some literature there. Well, what literature would you base it on? Well, if you know research on reflection and reflective practice, there's many different disciplines that have looked at that particular phenomenon. So what research should you base yours on? What literature should you ground your studies on? Well, if you had a theory in particular, maybe experiential learning theory, whatever type of learning, then it will help you delimit the literature on which to base your research. So I would say that grounded design is essential because it allows you to systematically study, continuously improve, and effectively utilize your instruction across context. And really, to get return on investment for your design, you typically want multiple instructors using a class or instructional set of materials. Okay, so getting back to the five steps. Did I answer your question on ground design? Okay. So let's select a strategy. What do you base your selection on? Your educational philosophy. What do you believe in terms of how and why people learn? Knowledge of various strategies that are out there, as well as the goals and objectives. So what do you know about learning theories? Well, if you look at learning theories over time, you could identify what I've identified as four basic classes, starting with behavioralism, really went into cognitive information processing theories of learning. We talk about constructivist learning that really, if you look at the research and literature, started earlier, 1930s, Piaget. And also what I think is very important now is cognitive neuroscience research. Any neuroscientists in the house? No. Sorry. How about engineers? Engineers? One engineer. Architects? Okay, let me see if I could explain one of the primary reasons I think cognitive neuroscience is so important. Engineers and architects, and many people, will design based on the relationship between structure and function. In order to predict human behavior, in order to design houses and equipment, they look at the structure and how it correlates to function, and then they do their designs. How many social scientists do we have in the room? Psychologists, education, okay. What have our measures of structure been based on to this day? Structure inside the brain. Very abstract measures, right? Because we don't really know what's going on inside the brain. So people would argue, cognitive neuroscientists would argue, that all the research that has been pretty much conducted up to the 1990s, paper and pencil, based on abstract conceptualizations of what's going on inside the brain. And they argue that that's the reason. What is the typical finding of educational research? It depends. It depends, right? Or no significant difference, or at best, mixed results. And they would argue that one of the primary reasons for that is because we've had abstract measures of structure and therefore we couldn't really correlate changes in structure with changes in function, and therefore properly predict or accurately predict behavior and learning. Cognitive neuroscience has totally revolutionized medicine over the last 5-10 years. Anyone had surgery in the last 5-10 years? Right? I've had surgery, near surgery. Totally, the advances in imaging technology, when we used to actually dig inside of you to figure out what's wrong, has totally revolutionized how we treat trauma states as well as psychological diseases and problems. To think that it won't lead to incredible insights now on how and why people learn, I think maybe a little short-sighted. So I think it's important for educators to stay abreast of what is happening in the cognitive neurosciences. So there's four classes. I would argue to really select and apply and ground your designs, it's important to have an understanding of these different classes of theories and how they differ and how they're similar. Okay, getting back to the framework, it's your educational philosophy, your explanation or your understanding of how and why people learn will guide your design or your selection of an instructional strategy. So what instructional strategies are out there? This is one of the handouts that are part of the package I have today. I think it's available to everyone who's here. I'm certainly sent it forward. You can all get a copy. This is actually just an outline. And I have another document that has more details about each of these strategies that I'd be happy to send to you. But here are some instructional strategies. So if learner-centered approaches, again, a sequence of interactions. If you look at these strategies, all these events are interactions that occur. We also included some behavioral and cognitive information, direct instructional approaches, and neurobiological or cognitive neuroscience approaches. And this actually, the interplay theory is the primary foundation for my talk tomorrow, which would be the masterclass, and what we're doing in terms of advancing experiential approaches to teaching and learning. Just as a quick promo for tomorrow, we're suggesting that experiential learning, we believe in experiential learning. People learn best when they are presented with authentic goals and challenges, and then they learn the concepts, facts, procedures, and process associated with solving that problem within the context of an authentic challenge or problem. Similar to what I've heard or seen in the conference called Flipping the Instruction. I think maybe some of you may have gone to some of the sessions or heard about flipping it, right? So basically, if you want to teach someone about a zoo, go to the zoo. Don't talk about going to the zoo, and you can do it virtually or through an authentic experience. So we're arguing that experiential learning is good. We believe in experiential approaches to teaching and learning. However, experiential learning theories and strategies do not systematically address the role of human emotions and imagination during the learning process, and therefore may not fully utilize the potential of emerging technologies to enhance learning. So we're looking at cognitive neuroscience research on emotions and imagination, integrating that with key concepts or conventions of interactive entertainment. Who knows better than entertainers in terms of evoking emotions and sparking the imagination? So we're using story, game, and play to evoke emotions, spark imagination, integrating that with experiential learning principles to enhance learning. So if you want to learn about how we're doing that, I would encourage you to come tomorrow and or just contact me if you can't, and I'll be more than happy to send you materials I have for tomorrow's session. So here are some outlines of various instructional strategies. Let's talk a little bit about how you would select one or more of these strategies. I mean, here Bloom's taxonomy. Okay? We have different taxonomies of learning. Many of you probably heard of Bloom's taxonomy. Here's a more recent updates to Bloom's taxonomy that has been published in the last 5 years, 10 years. Okay. Here's other taxonomies. I was lucky enough to actually have a year with Bob Gagne, who's considered the father of our field of instructional design. They all have defined taxonomies or different classes of learning outcomes. We have hundreds of years of research now that suggests that how you design and how you deliver your instruction should be based on your desired learning outcome. How you design a course or unit of instruction to teach someone facts should differ compared to teaching someone concepts, which should differ compared to teaching someone a process or procedure or problem solving. We have lots of research that really validates that the design should differ based on your desired learning outcome. How many of us actually change our instruction approach based on the desired learning outcome? Here's what I think is a good visual illustration of the difference between instructor-led and student-centered environments. Again, instructor-led, we have all the knowledge and experience in the instructor's head, and they're just pouring into, kind of like we're doing now. Where this is a more learner-centered environment. But this I put up because I think it's important to understand the best designers will pick approach based on the desired outcome. I look at a steak, or if you look at a steak, what do? You eat it. I salivate. You know what? Pavlov was right. Okay? Behavioral learning theories are accurate, but they don't explain all of human behavior, so that's why we come up with other models and theories. Not to say that they're bad, though. They just might not be sufficient depending on your desired learning outcome. Working with the military, there are still many desired learning outcomes that are based on very simple, straightforward procedures. One way of doing something, one correct answer. And I would argue, is it that bad?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
Getting the handouts.
Okay. And I would argue that the best designers will pick the approach based on the outcome. If you're training someone on how to use a photocopy machine, do you really need social constructivist approach to teaching and learning? I would say probably not. If you got a medical doctor who's about to conduct brain surgery on you, would you want him or her to construct his or her own way of doing so? I would suggest the answer may be hell no. However, if you want those brain surgeons to come up with better techniques and better approaches and solve ill-structured problems, then a more learner-centered approach may be appropriate. So again, based on your desired learning outcome, my general guideline is if you're teaching someone facts, concepts, and simple procedures where there's a one right answer or one right way of doing something, an instructor-teacher-directed method may be more efficient and appropriate. However, if you're teaching higher-order thinking skills where there's multiple correct answers or multiple ways of deriving that answer, and problem-solving and other cognitive strategies, then a more learner-centered approach may be more appropriate. So then, when we select a strategy, I typically recommend that people just start with what I call a simple instructional treatment plan. It takes me maybe 2 or 3 hours to do one now, maybe less. Okay? But a good way to start. So for a unit of instruction, let's say I just designed a new course on cognitive neuroscience, instructional design and learning. I selected the 5E instructional module. The 5Es include engage, explore, explain, elaborate, and evaluate. Learner-centered, very different because I'm not the one explaining. I engage learners through an event. I then give them direct access to the knowledge. In that student-centered model, you give the learners direct access to the knowledge base. And then they explain, the students explain, what they learned from their exploration. And then based on the student's explanation, then I elaborate or create some event or activity for them to elaborate on what they learned. and then I evaluate their elaboration. This will evolve as I go on. So then we've selected a strategy. In that case, it was the 5E model. You might select a different strategy depending on your context, your educational philosophy, and your knowledge of learning outcomes. So now we need to operationalize that strategy. As I was preparing for this session, I was looking around resources available in Canada, actually, came up with this categorization of instructional strategies by Saskatchewan. And I thought they did a pretty good job of, and if you check their website, they have a whole bunch of information about different instructional strategies. Now, they suggest that these are different instructional, all these are instructional strategies. I would argue that direct instruction, this is the level of instructional strategy. These are instructional events and activities. But I thought they did a nice job there. I really like the work of Smith and Reagan that's based on research on these Gagne's taxonomy. And again, here's another handout. And based on their analysis and synthesis of research over the last 50 to 100 years, they found that these are the different instructional techniques and events that have been correlated with facilitating the learning of verbal information, concepts, rules, procedure rules as well as principles. If your goal is to facilitate problem solving, these kind of events and activities have been found to be correlated to learning. Cognitive strategies, attitudes, and psychomotor skills. Again, that would be, all right, very happy to distribute them or have them, this handout for you. But again, the learning, the design of your instruction and the activities and events are grounded in some kind of research and theory and directly related to your targeted learning outcome. So going back to the treatment plan, I fill out the second column based on the strategy I selected, and now I'm thinking, how am I going to operationalize each of those events? What am I going to do to engage learners? What am I going to do to facilitate exploration? How am I going to get them to explain what they learned, elaborate on learning, evaluate their learning? Again, it doesn't really take too long. It takes me an hour or two to figure that out based on my knowledge of learning theories, learning strategies, and different instructional events that are out there. Kind of like a glorified lesson plan. Then I determine the interactions that are necessary. I've done this. I've selected my strategy. Now I'm trying to figure out what type of learner-human and learner-non-human interactions that I'm going to use to facilitate each of those events. And so I'm basing the interactions on pedagogy, my instructional strategy, my theory. I'm not just doing interactions because someone else told me to. Interactions are important. It's based on my design, grounded design. Then we get to mapping tools. Well, what tools are available? 1970s was deemed a decade of educational media, where we had handouts, film strips, overhead trends, all these kind of media. A lot of us are familiar with those, certainly where I started. The 80s, the decade of the personal computers. Then we had tools such as drill and practice, tutorial simulations, games, and productivity tools available to us to facilitate learning. 90s were deemed a decade of the networks. And now we had access to email, news groups, interactive television, listservs, World Wide Web, desktop conferencing. Now we're in the decade of advanced digital technologies. We have Web 2.0 technologies, which really allow the learners to construct knowledge and contribute to content, which I think is important to think about. Wikis, blogs, Twitter, mobile device, serious games, virtual world. Have a slew of technologies now available. What I liked about, oh, too bad he left. What I liked about what the Vice Provost said yesterday was we shouldn't be starting with tools. in the technology. We should be starting with pedagogy. Okay? So you select tools based on whether you have need to see audio, video, text, and graphics, or the media requirements. What are the interactions that you defined? How are the learners and instructor configured? How much money do you have? Obviously an important factor. And how much support do you have for the use of those tools? If you don't have the support and something goes wrong, you might have trouble. But again, what I liked about what the Vice Provost suggested was your decision in terms of what tools to use. When do I do chat? When do I do bulletin board discussions? When do I do video? When should I use a game? When should I use these different technologies that are now available to us is based on pedagogy. It's based on an instructional strategy that's grounded in research and theory. So now you could defend your selection of these tools based on pedagogy. So there you have your basic treatment plan. I tend to recommend the first time people design this kind of, or go about designing instruction in this manner, to analyze your interactions first before you actually go into prototyping. This is a treatment plan that was designed during a workshop I did on this topic by a faculty member from the College of Engineering. They selected the WebQuest instructional strategy that contains these events. She operationalized those strategies, defined the interactions, and the tools. On the surface, this looks very good, a way of teaching engineers how to create reports, engineering reports, feasibility reports specifically. But then, when you analyze these interactions, we found out that she had defined 8 learner-instructor interactions within a lesson. Well, think about 8 learner-instructor interactions in a lesson. She had 30 students in a class, so 8 times 30. She had 10 units of instruction within her course. 8 times 30 times 10. Okay. And then for each of these interactions, she had to acknowledge receipt of the communications and then respond to them. And sometimes organize them. It's like 3 other activities per event. Think of how many interactions that just occurred or were planned. How many of you heard about faculty going, I don't want to go online. It takes way too much time and energy. You've heard that argument? Well, I would argue it's not necessarily the media that makes that happen. It could be your designs. And if you're aware of the nature and the number of interactions that you're designing, based on this, far too many interactions need to review and reduce the amount of instructor-learner interactions. Learner-learner interactions as well. What are you going to make the students do in terms of interact? As good or committed educators that are conscious about learning, think back to the first time you taught a class. For some of us, that might be a little longer than others. But if you think back to the first time, did you assign too many assignments or activities and had to grade all these papers and went, oh, no, what did I do? Most conscientious educators do that because they want to make sure that people are learning. And I found that this also happens when you go online. You know interactions are important, so you design all these interactions to occur. But what is the ramifications? So I like to include this step. I would argue that over time, you learn how many different types of interactions to put in a class, and you won't have to think of it as much. But again, analyzing interactions is a good thing the first time out. So based on a lesson that I did for cognitive neuroscience, just to show you the prototype that came out of that, this is my unit in my class on cognitive neuroscience. You missed a hell of a lot of good stuff. Okay. So this is my unit using the 5E model. I come out with a picture. and an exciting video about the active dimensions of neuroscience just to engage the learner. I have them explore different levels of neuroscience research on emotions because I know my learner population has different degrees of knowledge of biology and anatomy and physiology. So I give them different levels of reading and videos based on, if they have no knowledge to advanced knowledge of neuroscience or anatomy and physiology, they get to pick what is the most appropriate level. But then they have to explain to me what they learned, and I like using Paul and Elder's criteria for critical thinking. So they have to demonstrate critical thinking in their explanations. So I evaluate their explanations based on these criteria. And then I have them elaborate on what they learned by asking them to work in teams now to redesign a unit of instruction based on what they learned about emotions and cognitive science research on emotions. And then I evaluate their elaborations based on these standards for reasoning. Also, Elder and Paul has published. So I have a rubric for evaluating their team project. And I've really found that we're doing research on this now. That students really enjoy this approach. We're evaluating it now to kind of forward our knowledge of the 5E model and come up with more generalizable results that people could use across context because it's grounded in an instructional strategy that's based on some learning theory. So then we, after testing that unit, then all the other units, I have 6 other units, it's a summer course, it's relatively short, on different lines of neuroscience research. Then I have a template, a basic design, then I fill in the contents and the development process goes fairly quickly. Okay, so now that you have, hopefully, a better understanding of interactions and student-centered learning environments, what must administration do, as well as faculty and staff do, to promote creativity and change? Because for many, going from a teacher-directed approach that they're so familiar with and comfortable with, moving to a student-centered environment requires creativity and change. So what must you do as administrators, faculty and staff and students to promote creativity and change? He's the president without here. Too bad he wasn't. I was wondering if he had a sense of humor. I hope so. So based on my experience the last 15 years, I found 6 keys to facilitating as I work with different organizations to help them create online coursework and programs. First, think systemically. We had a little discussion before today's session on all the different things that must be aligned to really facilitate learning. So great, you learn a different instruction approach, you design all this new curriculum, but then how you're evaluated isn't aligned to it. Or maybe the equipment isn't available, or the logistics aren't available. How does it align with research and theory and that kind of stuff? Do your academic services provide the support? I found that through talking to students, and there's some research out there, the students actually prefer online programs that provide good academic services but maybe poor quality instructional materials better than a program that has great coursework but poor academic services.
Can you just elaborate on what you mean by academic services?
Basically advising. And making sure they get the textbooks and the resources and they can connect and their technology works and all that kind of stuff. Okay? But also evaluation. How will faculty be evaluated for their work in creating these online courses and delivering online courses? If it's not, I found that what gets assessed is basically what gets done. So if it's not part of the evaluation, only heroes will actually go do this type of work. Unless faculty are evaluated on an annual basis based on whether they design and create these student-centered learning environments, I would argue that only the heroes or the early adopters, if you want to reference change theory, will go ahead and do so. If you want the majority of people to do it, it has to be aligned with evaluation. Evaluation of programs, as well as the evaluation of individual faculty member. What is your mission in terms of research and development? Does the university acknowledge and reward people who do research and development in this area? We know from experience as well as research and systems theory that if you change one aspect of the system through a grant or a special project, that change will actually disappear over time. Your system will go back to a steady state unless you continue to add energy or resources or align all the components to support that change. I would suggest if George Washington or someone from the past walked into most classes today, he was basically familiar with everything. Why hasn't things changed? We added computers many years ago to K-12 environments. Did we provide the professional development necessary for teachers to do that? Did we change the curriculum to support the integration of computers? So what has happened? Went back to what it was. So I would argue that if we want this change to move forward, you talk about kickstarting the program here at e.Concordia, I would suggest that you have to think systemically. What are all the components necessary to facilitate that change? How must they be aligned? We have lots of research on creativity and the conditions that catalyze and or inhibit creativity. Think about where you work today. Is your physical environment set up to inhibit or catalyze creativity? Psychologically, are the policies and procedures and daily activities in your work environment, is it designed to facilitate or inhibit creativity? I would argue many of us in universities, as well as in business and industry, focuses on error reduction and making sure everything comes out perfectly in an efficient manner. And we are so focused on reducing error and reducing excellence, all the training on operational excellence, hence the focus here. How much time is regularly allocated in your daily, weekly schedule to have fun and to play? Zero. How much time in your coursework is actually planned and designed to facilitate play? That's a great answer. And if one of the things you're trying to teach is creative problem solving, I would argue that some of it should be. That's a great answer. Thank you. She's listening. She needs to be rewarded. But I love this slide. You know, this is where the research, I synthesized research and found, these are the key factors. And I think it'd be interesting for each of you, as well as I go through this all the time. Have I designed my courses to do this? Or to do this? Is the environment online or physical more like this? Or is it more like this? So what are you doing in your role to foster creativity? In every organization, there's a population of faculty who aren't going to go online and do student-centered learning no matter what you say or do. But I've seen so many organizations spend a lot of time and resources trying to convince them, this is okay. You should do this. I'm going to give you time off. I'm going to, whatever. Don't waste your resources on people that aren't going to change no matter what you say or do. You're going to have early adopters. They're going to do it anyway. But these middle adopters, the majority of your faculty and staff, they're the ones that we need to spend the time and the resources helping them and to reach this vision you may have to achieve the outcomes. So resist the temptation to waste time and energy on people. Just say, thank you. I appreciate your efforts. Keep doing what you're doing. I'm going to go do something else. But you keep doing what you're doing. Persist, protect, and prevent. Some essential concepts. This is the implementation dip. Very well documented. Anytime you adopt a new technology, your performance will go down for some time. I think about the first time I word processed a document. It took me hours to come up with one page. But if it's a good technology, your performance will go up. The first time I tried a student-centered environment, pretty awful. Okay? But I knew and I had insights on that it would work over time. So I persisted, and over time, my student-centered environments are going better. So I think just understanding that everyone doing this will go through this performance dip. And you have to protect these people from normal policies and procedures so that they could go through that dip and feel okay with it. We know from change theory and research and literature that change takes time, 5, maybe even 10 years. So if you have an innovation and you want to change, you've got to protect that innovation and change. Maybe that cadre of faculty who want to do these student-centered environments and do research and test and go create this new stuff. You have to protect them, typically, from policies and procedures that may have been there based on old approaches and techniques, or established approaches and techniques. I also suggest that you have to prevent what we call the tragedy of the commons. What do you think the tragedy? Anyone heard of the tragedy of the commons? Okay. What?
It's that if you have a common resource, then one person starts to take more than their share. And if everybody does that, then the resource gets destroyed.
Similar. Okay. It's really based on the whole idea of democracy. So democracy is wonderful in many respects, right? But typically, when you have to reach consensus, you reach consensus at the lowest common denominator. That's the tragedy that occurs through democracy. You get the lowest common denominator because you feel like you have to get everyone to agree. So I actually like benevolent dictatorships. Do we have any benevolent dictators here? One faculty member that I really admired, Dr. Bob Morgan, he passed away a little while ago, changed the whole Korean education system. He didn't take glory in doing all that, but he really was responsible. And what they had was a benevolent dictator that really cared about the people, but what he or she said, what he said, was what happened. They didn't do this whole let's vote and make it all common and that kind of stuff. Okay? So as you go through this whole process, I just want to put that out there. That if you want change, you want to facilitate creativity, you may not want to try to get everyone to reach consensus on things. That often, if you do so, you reach the lowest common denominator. So to promote, foster creativity, promote change, I would suggest that you need to persist through these dips, protect the innovators, and prevent the tragedy of the commons. So in summary, we talked about differences between instructor-led and e-learning. Basically, the spontaneity of interaction and how interactions that typically happen spontaneously based on intuition by good educators, how they need to be planned, carefully planned, and sequenced in an online environment. And I talked about the various frameworks that are out there for for classifying different types of interactions. And they're wonderful, gain insights, but they didn't really show you the relationship between the interactions and how they relate to different technologies, their limitations. So I posited a three-level framework that I found that really helps me and have helped others create these online environments by distinguishing the first level, which is what you think and how and why people learn, your educational philosophy, and how that influences your selection of instructional strategy along with your targeted goals and objectives, and how that should drive the design and sequencing of your level two or your interactions that occur in your coursework. Talked about the importance of grounding your designs. Five steps for actually making those designs come alive. And then six keys for facilitating change and creativity. So I hope I have achieved my objectives. Each of you. And now I leave you with, what are you going to do? Because it's wonderful to come to a conference and to meetings. We get a lot of energy, a lot of excitement, right? But then you got to go back to work the next day, or maybe next week, or today. And when you go back to work, does that work foster creativity? Or does it tend to inhibit it? So what are you going to do now over time? Because now comes the work. So if I come back a year from now, and I really invite you all to come to Florida next year. Montreal's beautiful, but a little cold. Because I would argue that if you don't think about this and spend time and energy doing it, what we don't want to have is your students wearing this kind of shirt. So I thank you for your time and hope that this session was useful in some way or another. Thank you.